ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهدي الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت، وهو الحي الذي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يغيب عنها إلا هالك، وصلوات ربي عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم واجعلنا معهم يا أرحم الراحمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. O you who believe, be conscious of Allah like He deserves for you to be conscious of Him. Be fearful of Allah like He deserves for you to be fearful of Him. And die not except upon a state of Islam, a state of submission. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Say, shall I inform you? Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shall I inform you of those who are the lowest of the low? بالأخسرين أعمالا. Lowest in what? Lowest in their deeds. The most losers. The ones that have lost. As in they put something in and they got nothing in return. What? Who are they, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعِيهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Those whom their efforts were only in the worldly life. Only in the worldly life. And not only that, وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. And they think that they're producing good. So they made their entire life around one goal, and at the same time, they think they're successful. They think they're coming away with a lot. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, these are the lowest of the low. And you see here why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes clear that their concern revolves totally regarding this hayat al-dunya, all about the worldly life, making the most money, making the most production, excelling only in a worldly manner. Their entire livelihood is just work, produce. For what? For this worldly life. Meaning it does not transcend, it's limited. It does not go beyond this world. It's limited to this worldly life. It does not transcend into the hereafter. And so does that mean that anything that we do in this worldly life is useless? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, it is only in this category. They have no other category that they've invested in. And now when you invest some here, and you invest here, and you invest in different categories to make sure that you're making the largest outcome. You're getting the largest return in cash. And so you're making sure that you have, for those of you who are involved in the stock market, you're making sure you have just about as much in here. In here you have investments, so you don't put all your eggs in one basket. And the same thing applies to our hereafter. What we've done, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us in this verse, is that ضَلَّ سَعِيهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Their entire efforts revolved around this worldly life. And so our question is, our topic is, what is our concern? What is our motive that drives our efforts for this worldly life and the hereafter? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, he who awakens in the morning, من أصبح والدنيا هم, he who awakens in the morning and his entire worry is this worldly life. The Prophet ﷺ tells us, he makes the entire poverty, he makes poverty in its entirety right between his eyes. And he destroys his plans. And he feels like he's producing. Or she feels like she's producing. But it's all revolving
involved in this as soon as you wake up. Oh, I'm late for work. Oh my God. And what comes before that? Praying Fajr. That's not even in the question. SubhanAllah, yesterday we were sitting with a brother, and another brother offered him tea. And he says, no, I know myself. If I drink this tea, I won't be able to wake up for Fajr. See, he plans ahead of time. It's not just, okay, if I have time for Fajr, I'll pray Fajr. No, but it's this priority. Priority. But most of us, if not many of us, if the time comes, I'll do it. It's a secondary. It's not the primary goal. It's a secondary. And the primary goal is making sure I get to work on time. Making sure that at the end of the day, I meet the goal that my boss wants me to. Or if I am the boss, making sure that I leave work having produced just enough to meet my goals. Now, is there anything wrong with that? We've established that there's nothing wrong with that. But when that is the primary goal, when you make that the primary goal, الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعِيهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, all their efforts remain in this worldly life. And not only that, they think they're doing well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as if He's making fun of them. He's like, they think that they're coming away with much. It's like they're being fooled. By whom? By their own self. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us that the concern of the believer, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, وَمَنْ جَعَلَ الْآخِرَةَ هَمَّ, and he or she who makes the worldly life their concern, your concern as a believer. As a believer, your concern is the hereafter. Now, does that mean you worry about your job? No. Does that mean you worry about your kids and their sustenance and their income and their rizq? No. But your priority. Because a lot of people hear this hadith and they think, no, I shouldn't worry about the dunya, I shouldn't worry about school, I shouldn't worry about work. No, worry, that's okay. That you should be concerned. But akbar ham, what is your top priority? And notice in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, akbar ham is most top priority. What is your concern? Ask yourself, for all of us, to ask ourselves one-on-one, what is my concern? And you see the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim, their concern was worldly life in the beginning, before Islam. Worldly life. Making the most out of business, making the most out of your fame and your tribe and your family, getting to the top of this worldly life. And then the Prophet ﷺ tells us, and he who makes this the hereafter his concern, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes this dunya to come to him by force. It comes naturally. You wanted money, but you made the hereafter your concern. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you. And not only that, even if they have little, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that he makes their richness, their independence in their heart. They may have very little, but they feel that they're rich. Whatever comes, comes. And whatever doesn't, doesn't. But they feel a sense of contentment. And this is a reminder for all of us to reassess our priorities. Not to make things of our religion, matters of our religion, a secondary concern. We make them a primary concern. Right now, a lot of us, our concerns regarding our Qur'an. If I have time, I'll read Qur'an. But we never say, if I have time, I'll go to work. Right? Does anyone say, if I have time, I'll go to work? No. But same likewise with our religion. We make it the primary concern while also taking care of our obligations to our work, to our families, to our co-workers, to our kids, whatever it may be. But the primary concern is that our entire lives revolve around our religion. We schedule our events around our salah. You know you're going to work at 12 p.m. So you first ask yourself, when am I going to pray dhuhr? How am I going to be able to pray dhuhr? Am I going to have enough time to pray dhuhr? You're going in for a job interview. Are they going to let me pray dhuhr when I need to? Are they going to let me leave to go pray Jum'ah? That is a concern. Not, oh, let me just get the job and whatever. And then I'll try to No, but our concern as believers is that we please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to please Him for this afterlife. And then everything else will come, will fall into place. أَقُولُ قَالِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين. Your brothers and sisters, to illustrate this topic of having a strong concern for pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a strong concern for the afterlife, a strong concern for following in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's one story. And that is from a simple companion, not very famous. And this companion by the name of Thawbab radiallahu anhu, he was a servant for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would serve him and he would enjoy that he would be near the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sees him one day and he's very sad and not as usual in his smiling face and very cheerful. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wonders, why are you Thawban in the state that you are in? And he says, Ya Rasulullah, he says, I thought to myself, في الدنيا أستطيع أن أراك متى ما أريد. O Prophet of Allah, I can see you in this life whenever I want. And I love it and I enjoy it. And when I see you after a long time of absence, I get happy. But then I started thinking about the hereafter. I started thinking about the hereafter. وَفَكَّرْتَ أَنَّكَ سَتَكُونَ مَعَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَأَكُونَ أَنَا مَعَ الْعَبِيدِ. And I thought, O Prophet of Allah, I'm going to be with the slaves in maybe a lower part of paradise, and you're going to be in the highest with the Prophet. You're going to be in the highest level. So the whole point of the story is right here from Thawban radiallahu anhu, his concern. He's already like thinking beyond this life, beyond this world. Again, does that mean that we forget and we be reckless and we don't show up to work on time? And we don't take our efforts seriously. But that the main priority is that what happens after? Where will I be? And where will the Prophet ﷺ be? How close will my house in Jannah be to the Prophet ﷺ? How will the Prophet ﷺ be pleased with it? If you met the Prophet ﷺ in Jannah, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow all of us to be of those that meet the Prophet ﷺ and to be near him, will you be able to say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, kana hammi, O Prophet of Allah, your concern was my concern. I lived the same way that you wanted me to live. I lived and I worried about the things you worried about. I worried about my family just like you worried about your family. And as he says, khayrukum li ahli, you're the best of you and the best of your family. And he says, I worried about the da'wah just like you, O Prophet of Allah, worried about the da'wah. I worried about the ummah just like you, O Prophet of Allah, you worried about the ummah. So your concern is not just worldly life. You have a higher purpose as a believer. Your concern is not just getting food at 12 p.m. and then getting dinner at 6 and sleeping and that's it. Your concern is larger than that. And so this sahabi, Thawban radiallahu anhu, he's asking, O Prophet of Allah, where will I be? I'm worried. So the Prophet really did not have an answer for him at the moment. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused wahi to come down, he caused revelation to come down. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهُ وَالرَّسُولُ. First, and he or she who obey Allah and His Messenger. Allah and His Messenger. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Those are medical. Those will be with who? Those will be with the Nabiyeen, the Siddiqeen, those who are truthful, those who are righteous, the Shuhada, and those who are martyrs, the Salihin, and the righteous, وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا, and those who are the best of companionship. A companionship, a friend that is the best friend that you can think of. The best of companionship. So the Prophet says, to Thawban with these verses, you will be with those whom you love. And those whom you truly love, you truly obey them. And we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. And we wish to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all the prophets. We wish to have a good gathering. Just like we worry about who is in our clique, who is in our community, in our gathering in this worldly life, who our friends are. We worry about that in the afterlife as well. Who is our neighbors in Jannah? Just like right now, when they tell you when you go by a house, what comes first? The neighbor. And now you go, you think about your worldly life. You're living to be the neighbor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You're living to be in the best of companionship. And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in another hadith, "Anta ma'a man ahbab." You will be with those whom you love. You will be with those whom you love. Out of what? That concern that drove you, that purpose that drove you. It is not just for this worldly life. الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعِيُّهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. It is not just for this worldly life, just efforts for this worldly life. It is for the hereafter. It is larger than that. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولكل من له حق علينا. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين المظلومين في كل مكان. اللهم انصرهم على من عاداهم. اللهم انصرهم على من خذلهم. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين المظلومين في فلسطين وفي الصين وفي كشمير وفي سائر بلاد المسلمين. اللهم كل إخواننا أعونا. اللهم أعنهم ولا تعن عليهم. اللهم انصرهم. اللهم أيدهم. اللهم اجعلنا في زمرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم صل وسلم عليه في الأولين وفي الآخرين وفي الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه.